ngoja nitengeneze hapa kabla niwele. Okay, well, good morning. How are you doing? It is another beautiful Monday, new week, new events happening, such a event, yani the football, at least football in Kenya, is actually football all over is quite eventful, both in Cairo, in England, and right here at home with us. It is going to be a very interesting day today for one Nick Mwendwa, and we will wait to see what happens. There have been a lot of arguments and counter-arguments as to what exactly should happen, who's right, who's wrong, who is in the caretaker committee, are the people in the caretaker committee, do they understand football, is it peppering through the cracks, what is actually going on? But we're going to see all of this play out at least this week. Well, we have with us here Tijan Isaac Sula.
Umetoka Kisumu na inaji mingi sana.
Yeah, unajua ukishatoka katika the Girene, the home area, uh-huh. You have the blessing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so uko sawa.
Zeraburu is doing fine.
He's doing very well.
Ah, good.
Yes.
Karibu.
Asante sana. Uh-huh. Karibu sana. And we're going to join Mukami Beki wa Kupanda na Kushuka, aka Abwebwe, and Mukami Wambora there, still in Cairo. Of course, Vihiga Stars exited from that defeat by the Angels. But, you know, they still did well. They're going to tell us the lessons learned to see where do we go from here and such like stuff. John Kianda is on international break. But it is all good. Want to get into the discussion here. And Sula, there's been a lot of talk about Nick Mwendwa. We're going to be asking you the question of the day in just a bit as to what you think should happen in regards to football in Kenya. Because FIFA has now written back to Ambassador Amina Mohammed and said, you know what? Easy. This is not how we do things here. Please rethink. However, we want to dialogue. What do you think about that?
Well, yeah, a lot of letters flying left, right,
yes.
And center. This began midweek, I think, on Thursday, mm-hmm. when Ambassador Amina, flanked by PSG Okudo, announced that they were disbanding FKF and effectively forming a 15-man caretaker committee mm-hmm. to lead football going forward. And of course, within 6 months, there's a transition period which will pave way for the elections, after which the caretaker committee is expected to hand over
right.
to the guys who've been elected. Mina actually said that her decision had been informed by a report produced, or rather filed by Rose Wasike, the sports registrar, to audit the accounts of FKF. Probably, if we have that clip, it can get us going where Amina is making this announcement.
Yes, sir. Let's take a look at that important clip. This is the clip that set the ball rolling, as it were. I was wondering where it was. This is the clip that set the ball rolling, as it were. So let's take a listen to it.
Other jurisdictions in recent years, as you know, countries such as Cameroon, Egypt, Ghana, and Chad, amongst others, have had caretaker committees in place.
So she says, you know, she disbanded, and then she says that, you know, there's some sort of precedence. There are some caretaker committees that have been put in place. And we have the question of the day right now. We want to ask you this so that you can respond to it. Do you support the government's decision to disband FKF? Do you support the government's decision to disband FKF? Use the hashtag Daybreak, SMS 22422. You can also tweet at Willis Abura, Citizen TV Kenya. Do you support the government's decision to disband FKF? Amina is saying there is precedents. What will Mefanya, Cairo, Chad, all these other people have done it. So we can also do it.
Of course, precedents are all over. Mm-hmm. Actually, she forgot to mention that even in Kenya, we've
yes.
had precedents.
Right.
When Maina Kamanda was mm-hmm. sports CS, he formed a caretaker committee. Mm-hmm. When Dr. Paul Otuoma was sports CS, he actually formed a management committee to oversee and manage Harambee Stars.
Mm-hmm.
And if you go back, Kenyan sport history is littered with these committees, or caretaker committees, if you so wish,
mm-hmm.
they have been formed. Najib Balal, again, when he was a sports CS, he also did a similar thing.
Mm-hmm.
But as you saw, even from the letter which FIFA was sent yesterday evening, which we just had this morning, later on it will be playing on the screens, is that once you government actually comes on board and tries to flex its muscle, FIFA will tell you that we have zero tolerance to third-party interference. So in this case, the government is deemed as a third party according to their statutes. Mm. So chances are high, should these two parties not come to a common ground, Kenya could be sanctioned. A sanction here meaning a ban. So when they say they'll ban or suspend FKF, because this is the body they deal with, this is the body they recognize in Kenya. Right. So suspending FKF means Kenya has been suspended. We've been banned. So we won't be able to compete international tournaments. That's the national football team, Harambee Stars, the national women football team, Harambee Starlets, our clubs such as Gor Mahia, AFC Leopards, and Waterview. Even Vihiga Queens will not be able to compete in these inter-club competitions. Mm. So that's basically what we expect. And during this period, all the FIFA grants that are meant for FKF or Kenya will be frozen. We won't be able to get any. Our referees or match officials will not be able to travel beyond our borders to officiate these international matches. So yes, for the footballer, that's the number one stakeholder in this, will bear the brunt most. They'll feel the pinch most.
How long is the...
It will depend, actually. It's not definite. They could say we are slapping a definite ban or we are suspending Kenya for 2 or 3 or 1 year, depending on the decision they are going to make. Right. If the letter we had this morning, actually, and the Secretary General of FIFA who signed that letter was categorical that they are open to dialogue with the sports ministry via a video conference addressing that letter to Amina. So I'm hoping probably Amina,
so do you think, seeing what we've seen, do you think dialogue will kind of give us a sort of way forward, especially now with the arrest and now appearing in court?
I don't think it's going to break the impasse, because in that letter, FIFA is very categorical. They want Amina to retrace her steps and recall the decision she made, rather do away the caretaker committee. There goes that letter in part. And basically what they're telling Amina is, you've meddled, do away the caretaker committee, have the FKF National Executive Committee run the FKF affairs. Remember, Nick is the president. Just beneath him is the vice president of the federation. That's Doris Petra. Then we have the National Executive Committee, who are representative of respective regions. We have a representative from Coast, from Nairobi, from Nyanza, Western, and Waterview. So these are the men and women who run the federation. Then now you come to the secretariat, which is headed by Barry Otieno. Yeah. So a CEO or Barry Otieno is an appointee. He's not elected, he's an appointee of the FKF leadership. Mm. So he reports to the FKF NEC led by the president. Mm. So Barry Otieno with the secretariat now does the day-to-day activities of the federation. Mm-hmm. But at this point in time, you saw the body language of Amina. She was diplomatic but very tough. I don't think she's going to eat her words.
And she's used to kind of this.
Absolutely, because even though the appointment of the caretaker committee, the government has gone ahead and gazetted them. Mm-hmm. So that tells you it's binding. It's all systems go, so to speak. And remember, this coming in the backdrop of Harambee Stars actually hosting Rwanda today in their final World Cup qualifier. Right, right. And what I can tell you is these two bodies actually working together. They are part of the FKF secretariat, who actually the committee have been consulting in one or two, just to ensure that today's match goes on without any hiccups.
But you know, it's it's very interesting. And I mean, the government did what it did, but like I said in the beginning, ingekuwa hata heri wange consult kidogo as to who they're putting in the committee. But anyway, because you know, have to have some sort of sports background. Do you think, Asula, it is worth it to go ahead and get the ban?
Well, if you ask me, probably, if we can retrace the steps, actually.
Yes.
Because, and Lins will be projecting that. How did we get here, probably?
Right.
That maybe is where we need to begin. And maybe Lins in a while with that graphics will help us break it down. Mm-hmm. But the question the sports ministry is asking, mm-hmm. we've pumped around 550 million mm-hmm. into FKF. That's
right.
According to the...
we are looking at the monies. Yeah,
absolutely. Right. Look at that. That's now counting the cash. Mm. And that's just a sneak preview If you look at that report, it's quite in-depth. Mm. And you can see in 2017, or 2019 rather, when we last hosted SECAFA, they're saying they advanced 5 million rather, for SECAFA preparations, and that's what's just in addition to the 20 million that had been given out. Mm-hmm. Then now, I think the nail in Nick's coffin was the over 200 million, as you can see from the graphics, mm-hmm. that was advanced for Harambee Stars preparation mm-hmm. for the Africa Cup of Nations. This was in Egypt. Mm-hmm. And according to that report, or according to the ministry, if they do their audit, they can't really see all the documents right. are backing up the use of these monies. Mm-hmm. So it is based on this, I believe. You remember when the cabinet secretary wrote to the federation mm-hmm. saying they should open their books for audit.
Right.
And the federation again fired back mm-hmm. saying the sport registrar should not lead this process because she has been a partisan mm-hmm. Person in the entire process.
Right.
So basically this is where the trouble all began. And then you remember the disbanding of the federation, Nick Mwendwa calling a presser to rubbish everything. Mm. Then a day late again, he is arrested. As we are speaking, actually, still in custody, and probably he'll be arraigned this morning. And if we can go ahead, Lindsay, probably now we can go look at Nick Mwendwa, where it all began.
Right.
When he rose to the throne, that's the FKF leadership. This was in 2016 elections. You can see there, he's pretty a young man. He was elected in 2016. That's for the first time.
Yeah.
In that election, he beat Ambrose Rachier. It was quite a strong victory. Then after that, of course, his major highlight since he took over was leading Harambee Stars to the AFCON finals, mm-hmm. which I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. Then thereafter, when now he was seeking a second mandate, remember in 2019 and all this furore over election, the Sports Dispute Tribunal led by Counsel John O'Haga nullifying the election. Then, of course, on October 11, 2020, mm-hmm. he earned a fresh mandate again. Look at the margin. 77 votes out of 85 that were up for grabs. Mm-hmm. Then on November 11th, that's on Thursday this week, Sportsiers Amina Mohamed basically bringing his reign to an end, at least as things stand now. A day later, FIFA fires a warning to Kenya. Then on November 12th, he's arrested. Mm-hmm. This morning again, now FIFA, through Secretary General, has written another letter referring to the earlier one they wrote on Friday regarding this matter. So this morning, he's going to be produced in court,
right,
just to be arraigned. And from there, I think all this gonna play out. We don't know the end game, but probably FIFA's called for a meeting with Amina via video conferencing. I'm sure she's going to respond to that, and we're going to see how this pans out. The interesting thing, as I said, this afternoon, Harambee Stars will be in action. That's taking on Rwanda in the World Cup qualifiers. It's a dead rubber match, so to speak, mm-hmm. because if we win even by 10-0, it will count for nothing. Remember, we've not lost any single game since the qualifiers began, drawing away in Kigali, drawing away in Kampala, drawing at home with the Uganda Cranes, losing to Mali away in Morocco, and at home. So that's where we are. It's a dicey situation. We're going to see how things pan out.
All right. Well, we have some feedback, and okay. We have some. Let's take a look at some feedback in a few minutes, because we're asking you if you support that. We have Jaro Soja here as we, take a look at that. Jaro Soja, who said, let me see here, and this is what he says. He says, okay, I won't read the second one. Let me read the first one. He says, if FIFA will have to defend Mwendwa, then let them bring the ban. Kenya is ready. There will be no dialogue to bring back Mwendwa in football. Let's forget about that. Na ni sisi mashabiki ndio tunaumia. This is Jaro Soja, Gor Mahia 001. Now, it's very interesting to talk about this, because now two people as each has a hardline stance. We have the government, who also will not want to look like they've been bullied by Nick Mwendwa.
Absolutely.
Then we have Nick Mwendwa, who is banking on the backing of FIFA. Mm-hmm. But I just want to ask, in terms of even what FIFA will view, what will FIFA view of a president who has been arrested and is now in court and stuff like that? Does it have any impact in sort of what it is, how they view it?
Of course, it has an impact. Remember, FIFA does its own audit, by the way, mm-hmm. of all the federations. Mm-hmm. Interestingly, when they do this audit, you'll never get to see the report like what we saw with Amina.
Right.
And even interestingly, as I answer that question, Barry Otieno, in that report by the sports ministry, it's very interesting when you read the findings, and
right.
he says that FKF is a private entity, mm-hmm. which the rapporteurs disagree with, saying this is a public entity, it needs to be guided by the Procurement Act of Kenya, Employment Act, and all those roles, laws governing our land.
Yeah.
And according to the report is that guys have been unprocedurally hired and unprocedurally fired from the federation. Remember the national team coaches. We all know how that turned out, leading yes. to litigation, losing a lot of money. And now, if the government feels right now, it's a time to clean up the rot in the federation, uh-huh. ensure that whoever comes on board runs the federation, cognizant of the Kenyan laws, as guided by the Sports Act and any other statute, any law within the constitution. They believe this has not been happening. Mm. Now, regarding the ban, I don't think Amina is really going to play softball and probably let this go. I think she's going to stick to her guns. Most likely, there could be an indefinite ban. Uh-huh. And at this point in time, I don't think really Kenya gonna miss much, because we are out of the World Cup qualifiers. Uh-huh. And even at the international scene, really, we've not really done well. Except the women football. We saw them compete at the Alcon. Right now we have Eager Queens who are bundled out, but they made a statement of intent, of course. Right now, one of the 8 best teams in Africa. So that ban, basically, if you read the mood in the ground, most sports footballers support the action Amina has taken, mm. because they feel probably the federation has not done well. Remember the running battles between Gor Mahia and FC Leopards. Mm. You see the reaction of Kakamega Homeboys chairman, Cleophas Shimanyula. So you sample the reaction from the stakeholders, and you feel a good number of them thinks this is the right way to go. Because in my view, at this point in time, I don't think we are going to lose much. And I believe Amina, being the diplomat she is actually going to have talks with FIFA. And this has happened in Cameroon, for instance. In Egypt, remember, even the military, actually when it was disbanded, it was the military that was put there to manage football. Uh-huh. So it has happened. Basically, well, they ban us, but after some time, once this rot is over, they're going to lift those sanctions. Uh-huh. It has happened before. Unfortunately, my only regret is even the caretaker committees that were formed by Najib Balala and Maina Kamand, actually, we've never really cleaned our sports or football holistically, because you look at even the state of the national team, it's very dire. And I think in the last 4 or 5 years, the government has pumped in a lot of money. We've never seen this with the past federations. Mm. And it's unfortunate.
They say it's about 430 million.
Yeah, that's what they're saying.
Yeah, that's what they're saying. last question, and before we jump across over to our colleagues in Cairo. So what would happen in terms of the way forward, right? Let's say, I don't know, whatever happens in court happens, Amina stays, we get banned. Is there a process now to make sure that what happens, the caretaker committee, how long does it sit? And then how do we get to, probably, if it comes to it, a new president?
Yeah, basically, the caretaker committee, led by retired judge Aaron Ringera, the mandate is very clear, not just to manage football, but come up with a roadmap of election. Mm. Remember, they are just there within 6 months.
Right.
So it is Aaron Ringera-led team that will hand over the mantle to the new leadership, whether it's Raburu who will be elected. Mm. Now, Aaron Ringera will lead that. Yeah. But now, what we are likely to see, I foresee a lot of litigations. Guys are probably going to run to the sport tribunal seeking these orders and what have you. Mm. At the weekend, I saw some candidate in Mombasa has already launched his campaign, wanting to replace Nick Mwendwa. And remember, Amina was very clear. Mm-hmm. Going forward, they have to lead the federation in line with the FKF constitution, FIFA statutes, and of course, laws of the land. So even as they plan for this election, there has to be a lot of consultation between FIFA, CAF, and FKF, because chances are, yes, we could run into that election, but FIFA says we don't recognize whoever's come on board. So there's going to be a lot of consultation, a lot of back and forth.
And also bear in mind, we have an election.
We have an election, yeah. So
the 6 months will take us to what, July, June?
Thereabouts.
Yeah,
thereabouts.
And then of course in August there is an election. And anyway, let me tell you what, it's going to be quite something, but definitely we're going to keep tabs on it. Of course, you know, we're going to be writing about it. We're going to be talking about it both on TV and on radio. But today is a significant day as Nick Mwendwa is going to appear in court. We wait to see how that what happens in that regard. I want to cross over to Cairo now, where the Vihiga Queen